Good evening. My name is Deborah Thomas, for those of you who don't know me, and welcome to what we're calling Dash, an interruption of Triangle Theater. Before we begin, thanks so much to the Arts Center here in Carrboro for hosting this conversation, and thanks to New Play TV, a program of HowlRound for live streaming us. If you'd like to contribute to the conversation, those of us who are watching online, you can tweet us with hashtag NewPlay. Unfortunately, the briefest of introductions will have to suffice for these ladies here with me tonight, for even a modest list of their accomplishments and work history would fill our entire hour this evening. In no particular order, we have co-artistic director of Both Hands Theater and playwright Cheryl Shambly here at the other end. We have actor of stage and screen and theater educator, Lori Mall. We have actress, actor, director, and theater educator in the local high school system, Hope Hines Love. The other co-artistic director of Both Hands Theater and playwright, Tamara Kissing. Lecturer and resident dramaturg at Duke Theater Studies, Judith Odendahl James. Actor, director, writer, instructor, and funny girl, Katya Hill. And actor, singer, dancer, and choreographer, Lamara Jones. And behind the camera, we have Sylvia Mallory, who is a local director and part of the impetus of this. So a little bit of an introduction for the conversation. We decided to call this an interruption rather than something a little that made more sense. because there's a conversation that's happening locally in the Triangle Theater scene that happens every year about what plays get produced and who gets hired to make those plays happen. And this is certainly a conversation that is taking place nationally with what happened at Guthrie and all over. Women everywhere are going, hey, wait a minute. It's time for us to step up and have this conversation, and how can we bring our voices to the table? And so we felt that the term interruption kind of spoke to that a little bit. The goal of this discussion tonight is to start to piece together the ways local female artisans can better support each other and the breadth of theatrical opportunities that we have here locally. We know this is just, we're not going to solve all the problems tonight, certainly with who we have here. More voices need to be added to the table. This is the beginning of the discussion, but we do want to get to the end and feel like maybe we can make a way. So the question that I'm going to start with, and again, this is a conversation, so please jump off of each other and speak to each other. Not that you can't come on.
Women who are very assertive in leadership roles, how they do it so naturally, how do they is it a handicap to be considered a woman director, right? Would you like to just be considered a director? Because there are, and I think we're talking about, or at least in analysis that I've done, the focus tends to be on directors and playwrights. That doesn't necessarily cover the breadth of women working in theater in this town. We have a huge amount of scene designers, and I don't think anybody would sort of choose a would approach their job as a scene designer thinking first about I'm a woman or I'm a man, or that they wouldn't get hired based on the woman or man. Yet, I do think there is something to be said, you can look at data about it, that women are chosen oftentimes to direct women's plays, specifically because the assumption is that we are have a greater affinity. That also then keeps us from, and I speak as someone who's trained as a director and work as a dramaturg now, that somehow I then am not given a breadth of opportunities, because the assumption is that I would direct a women's play. And I built a career on that. I liked that. That was something I was happy to do, but I also understand where that put me in the larger hierarchy of that. And so I think there are people who resist that, women writers as well, sort of like, well, I don't want to just be done because you need a woman in the slot. I want to be done because my play is worthy. Right? So I want to be thinking about that. So how do we address, I think it is a disparity, and I have numbers if we want to talk about that, about how many women are being hired, how many women playwrights are being done in the season next year. But then how do you also want to reserve from that and go, okay, but we're artists, and we want to be able to all work from the same playing field and not make assumptions about gender, about race, about these other identity markers over what we can do as artists. So how do we both demand sort of sense of representation, but also say, that's not the only thing I want to be represented or hired because I represent.
And I can back you up on that, because I don't go out seeking directing work. I have a full plate as a high school director, so when I have the opportunity to direct professionally, it's usually I'm being approached. And I joked, by the time I'd done Eye of God and Boy Gets Girl, I was like, can I direct a play where a woman is not assaulted? Like, can I get approached to direct a play that's, you know, a comedy? That would be nice. And so, right, that naturally they go, oh, we'll go to that person. I was like, I would not like to be the director who gets women killed on stage. Yay! And I also think, I was thinking about parody. I was thinking today about the lifetime syndrome, that even when plays are about women, I think we develop habits. We teach the way we were taught, right? We tell stories the way we've always heard stories. And even when the story is about women, I call it the lifetime story, I've seen Frozen and I've seen Doubt. Doubt I have yet to see directed well. It's a woman's play. It's a play about nuns, and it always ends up being directed about the priest. And if you have a play that's about women, but we tell it like the man is the central character, those characters, it disservices both sexes, both genders, because those characters then either have to be the monster or the hero. They're flat. That play is about the lack of power women had in the church at that point, that they could clearly see a problem, and their hands are tied to do anything about it, because they're women.
I think we yearn for plays and experiences that are a full expression of being a woman, and we don't really feel like we have it, or we wouldn't be sitting here talking. We've had some, but so I think the answer was that quality experiences are different for each individual. I come from the background of having a full-time great career as a professional actress for 20 years, and so I had to transition and find a second career to make a living when I moved here. So. And why? Because I aged out of roles. And I know we all know that's the story, but when it happens to you, it's very personal, and it's not so fun. So I speak to it because now that's the minority I'm in. What's hard about it is that you're sort of, no one knows what to do with you, and sometimes I don't know what to do with you. So I teach because I was teaching, I fit in where I can fit in, but why isn't there a place for me to go? Right. And why do I have to go see my former male co-stars who are still working? And I'm not bitter, but it is true. And until that's not fully true, there's something still off. I should have a place to go.
Right, when their wives are, it's every chunk of you. Well, on stage, you're good.
Well, yeah, all my husbands and a lot of commercials were always like, but, and I had children in commercials who who were 15 and I was like 30. And I thought, well, when did I have them? That's like a whole other conversation, but that's what I yearn to do. I yearn to do things where I can fit in, and I don't really care if it's as assistant director or as a teacher or anything I can do to evolve this forward, because I want the next generation of women to work longer than me. I want them to be working professional actors as long as their male colleagues. I feel really strongly about that. Not a little longer, you know, as I did, but as long as your male co-stars. That's what I want to see, and I yearn to be directed by a woman, like, really get inside my head and help me say more, because, and I don't want to do another story about domestic violence or rape or just be an airhead.
Right, or just be there to serve the male lead, you know, as a female.
Right, or objectified, which I know.
It's really interesting to me to hear what you guys are saying, I think partly because, when we created Bohan's theater company, it sort of ended up that we were creating our own opportunities to direct and be in stuff and write stuff. And I don't think we did that because we're women. We just did that because we wanted to make these shows. And even now, Helm of our own theater company, we're starting to have discussions about how we can create quality opportunities for ourselves and for other people, particularly with young children, particularly women with young children. And I think that creates a whole other dimension. There's the opportunity itself, sort of the artistic part of the opportunity, but then there's also the logistical part, right, of the opportunity, whether you can take advantage of it or not.
Right,
that's right.
We just had a conversation at a conference about trying to, I mean, just at the very base level, look at length of rehearsal times at professional theaters during the day for women who have children who are on the artistic staff but are not the director. Mm-hmm. And so how do you sort of get the, when you have probably actors, writers, dramaturgs, scene designers, right, people who are around, you know, being in the room, but also how the difference in power, who can bring that up? Can an actor negotiate and sort of say, no, I can only, you know, you get hired out, someone else would take over for you. So thinking about notions of the very particulars of women who choose to have children and want to also still work, that they don't find themselves without some kind of recognizable net, I mean, for doing the business that they have to do. And it was really interesting because someone said, well, please say that. You can say that to the director as dramaturg, and an actor would not risk that, right? And so you help everybody by trying to make this larger, bring up this larger point. And even it's just sort of like, can we have rehearsal from 10 until 6, 10 till 5, so I can pick up my kid from childcare, right? So also realizing, too, that things I want for myself, when I make that suggestion, I'm also, hopefully, I'm thinking about the other women in the company. You might not voice that, you might not sort of, you know, bring all of that to the table because their position necessarily is a little more precarious than mine.
Huh. Well, I know that, I mean, I'm sure everybody's read the Anne-Marie Slaughter article about women who still can't have it all and all of that. And I've been thinking, we've been talking a lot about what, if it's possible to be a theater artist, especially if you don't make your living entirely through your art, right? If you have a job doing something else during the day, and at, you're used to going at night, rehearsing 5 days a week, and then having 12-hour tech rehearsals, especially if you're producing your own shows and directing your own shows, then you're doing even more than just attending the rehearsals. And it's just not a very family-friendly model. For me, it is not sustainable. And I do feel like there are lots of opportunities, but I can't be available for the opportunities because of the way that our current models of creating art are set up. And so, you know, it's of great interest to me to think about how can we flex those, take them apart, reinterpret, make accommodations, because I feel like just at the point when I was, you know, ready to keep going, like really had momentum, then here comes the baby, who I love. But that has been my creation. And
because there's no structure in
it's a conversation that is happening in the administration world from an audience perspective.
Yes. Yes.
A lot.
Yeah.
Because people, what we find is outside of the kind of the 60 plus demographic who's getting to vote for him and gone, they're certainly the majority of our audience. And then, but when, once you get lower than that, that coveted, you know, mid-20s to 50 demographic have kids at home. What do they do with the kids to go see a show?
And then how much does it cost them?
And so it's a conversation that happens from an audience perspective, but it's not a conversation that is happening from the artistic, from the worker perspective.
And planning for this panel today, Deborah,
right.
You and I have talked about this model, that could we do a co-op where the five theaters say, your theater, Thursday nights, if you're a ticket holder or you're a season holder, we have daycare at our theater. And we have daycare on Friday at this theater and Saturday.
Right.
But then also, could you expand that? I mean, I'm actually thinking about it as a business model, like, could I make it my second job? That you have rehearsal care. Because even if I was willing to pay for daycare, who am I going to find that's 5 to 11?
Yeah.
And really what I need is, I need 7 little cups.
Right.
And lullabies. Yeah. And so that I can come in at 6:30,
and it's interesting,
get my baby ready,
because,
lay it down,
right.
and put him in the car seat and go home.
Right.
Then his routines are in
right.
my routines.
And I don't understand, what I don't understand, and I know we're kind of getting off of the quality of routine section, but we can totally jump into support structures.
The quality of routines is how I do it.
Right.
Yeah.
Is that in the healthcare industry, they have round the clock care built in. I mean, I can remember babysitting kids whose parents worked at the hospital second shift, and we would go out and I would take them back to the on-site care. So I'm really confused from the artistic world why that has not come up as an option. Is it a money issue?
Is it an insurance issue?
Yeah.
I mean,
yeah,
insurance on-site care is immediate. I mean, because again, I don't mean to say, we just had this discussion 2 weeks ago, and immediately one of the, it was at the Alliance Theater in Atlanta, and she's like, that'd be great. We can't cover it. Our insurance can't cover it. In fact, we could call it creative play. You know, like you could teach them something, and then that would be something you wouldn't have to get licensed for in the same way that you do with child. But again, you're also then dealing with children that are of a certain age. So you both have, you know, in the same way back to the Anne Marie Slaughter, you're sort of looking at women, if you choose to have children, so that's the first sort of thing, and then want to have this as a career, you're also dealing from a certain age point where you're really having to, you're in or you're out, to manage both of them. And I think men struggle with this as well.
Yes.
But I don't think it has the same, we're still sort of in this space of a kind of cultural identity that a woman is expected to do it. I'm in the same-sex relationship. It's also who has the job, right?
Yeah.
So it's not necessarily completely gendered. It's about the family income and the structures of the day. So, you know, that's there. So every couple is dealing with that in some way, or, you know, people who don't have a couple, you know, someone else there to help them, that becomes something that you can't even compromise with, and there isn't another person to sort of help you out.
It is a national discussion. A lot of companies are looking at culture of their, what makes people stay, and childcare is. But I was so sure before this, I had one of a great experience years ago doing a production, and the choreographer was nursing her baby at the time, and there were a couple of other cast members who had young children, and we had cribs at the back of the rehearsal studio, and a baby was crying, and the mother would run, or somebody else, it was great. It had no effect whatsoever on getting the production.
Was it all women who were doing that?
No,
it was
a male director, male musical, for the musical is loud. And there were children in the show. It just sort of gave it this great atmosphere, and it was very creative. And
but you're talking about power structure. It does take someone at
a level of
power to say, we all agree, this is okay.
This is how we're doing it.
Because I want to use, you know, and if I was a director and I wanted to use an actor who had come from New York, we're going to pay equity contract. That's the deal. I want this person. And so there's got to be more voices of power that say, I want her, and she's still nursing her baby, so guess what? can we cast one of our volunteers as a rehearsal chair?
Right.
Do you feel like that's true in this community, though, that you have to be in a position of power to suggest that?
I would not, if I was casting a show, dare to suggest that part of my pay. I'm not suggesting that. I just got cast in a fall show.
Uh-huh.
And I'm paying the nanny who fortunately lives with us more to take care of my baby, but never. And I'm very close to the director, and I think the director, but it would never even occur to me. It's undone, right?
Because of the money part of it? Or
because it's you're more of a pain in the fanny.
Yeah.
You're marking yourself as a needy actor.
Or just an... You know, in some sense, it's just sort of like...
That's your stuff. Take care of it.
Yeah. I mean, you're sort of bringing your work, your homework, to work. And partly because I think it would be different. I don't know if you're rehearsing during the day. If this is a company, you know, like...
No, it's company rehearsals.
Right. So it rehearses at night. So we have... I mean, we're also, in our digital dealing with quality opportunities, we have so many different kinds of theaters in the area.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
So we have these million, you know, people that have an endowment, a season structure, a large staff, lots of shows every semester. in school.
A set season
subscribers, large staff.
They do the same amount of productions
every year. They can rely on that regularity. Then we have sort of middle of the road, people that have a building, and they do some shows, but they house in a lot of other people. And then we have a lot, at least, I think it's like 16 itinerant companies,
sure.
Which basically sort of job bounce around. Productions are done as regularly as they can be based on that. So also, too, I always think to trying to hold each one of those sets of groups accountable or compare what they do or how they make their choices seems a little difficult because they are not working or not working on the same ground.
That's right.
That being said, a place that has a large institutional structure, like a business, should be able to be a space where if you have a child care issue, you know what I mean? If part of your work is affected by how you need to take care of your children, you should be able to voice that or have a space for that. And I don't think, not because anybody's mean or horrible, but I just think because it isn't part of the regular culture.
Because if I took a show in Raleigh, I would make mention of the fact that the gas, I remember when gas prices were high.
Yeah,
I would say, dude, I can't take this job for this money because I'm going to lose money. Like, you're not paying me enough to do for gas.
Right.
But I would never say, you're not paying me enough. I'll lose money for the child care. You're paying me $3 an hour and I'm paying $10 an hour.
That's kind of why I asked the question. Because I know that, as a director, definitely brought issues to us about day job kind of issues, other commitments to other theater companies, types of issues. I mean, there are definitely other family vacation type issues that people have brought to us, and you know, we either can work with them or we can't work with them.
But they were brought to you.
But they were, certainly.
They were at least reached.
Yeah, so I guess part of why I asked you that question was sort of this amazement of,
And I think it's odd, like even examining it, I'm like, that's odd. But there's something in the back of your brain that says, no. I even feel guilty running my own theater at the high school where I have the most autonomy and the most power. When my child has to crash a rehearsal, I feel less professional.
Strange. I mean, theater is 100% human resources.
Yes.
You better not have any human needs. You've got to be vulnerable enough to cry at the drop of a hat, and you've got to be titanium tough and somehow so solvent on these fiddling salaries. You're not going to be solvent on your day job either, because any kind of day job that you have, lucky enough to have, I don't know, is inevitably going to have to be so small with such discrete requirements that you can actually do it and, you know, be at the theater and hope and whatever, not fail horribly, not embarrass yourself, that, you know, you're not going to really advance there either. So you're almost kind of kept in this limbo.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
huge advocate for getting people to ask for things, even if it's just asking for a little more money, because I'm sorry, the arts are a profession. Mm-hmm. It's a profession. It was my profession for a long time, and it they are an occupation, and you kind of have to think of yourself that way.
Mm-hmm,
if you call yourself a starving artist, please erase that and stop saying it. It's perpetuating in our culture that you're not supposed to be paid for your skills. That's absurd.
Well, just thinking about this new Cluniers campaign this past year, it's been Artworks, right? And all about the economic engine of the arts. And we just had a major report that's been touted all over North Carolina about how much money arts groups are bringing into the economy in a state that's where they're working for that. And then I sort of feel like there's this strange disconnect, and maybe it's to what you said, Katya, about not being human, is that, yes, it is a business, it is an engine, we need to invest, and we need to think of work, really think of ourselves as work. But then when it comes to this sort of thing, well, don't get too business, then you might offend somebody who's not going to hire you the next time around. We're family. You know, and so there's this kind of informality of how people work or how companies work, and that sort of thrives on people sort of being deferential and not, you know, sort of going, oh, well, I know we're all starving and we're all on a shoestring, and therefore I won't really sort of walk in and go, this is unacceptable, or I can't work like this. This is my livelihood, and therefore these things sort of have to change. So there's, again, a bit of a tension between how what we're trying to, I think, represent for ourselves nationally and, you know, as a profession, and then how we work within our institutions, especially because so many of them are struggling, so many companies hand to mouth. And so you don't want to not have the opportunity, and you don't want to be the person that sort of says to the company that's just like you, you know, no, I'm sorry, you know, these are the things that I must have.
Because negotiation doesn't happen when you're in triage mode.
Right. Like you're not on the ground to really have a rational a rollout plan conversation, right?
Although, I will say that I'm sure you guys have had this experience too. My experience is that in the theater world, especially locally, the work that we do and the art that we make is based on the relationships that we have with each other.
Yeah.
And so, so this is a great opportunity to really dig into those relationships and have conversations. In particular, I'm excited about these, we call them the itinerant companies.
Theater with people who are like us. Our audiences are like us. And the more I think this group is a great idea, because the more you can use social media to extend your diversity, then you have a 17-year-old volunteer who doesn't mind watching your kid for the opportunity to get a credit on their application for NYU. Like, the larger you have, the more you have the ability to fill in the pieces. But I do think that one of the things about our smaller companies and our larger companies, they're isolated, right? Like, if you're a professional company, you know all the equity actors, and you're isolated, and you don't know that, oh, all those LECOs that we have downstairs that nobody's had time to fix, they'll take them, fix them, use them for their show, and return them because they had a massive amount of volunteers, right? And so those kinds of resources that could be shared.
Relationships. I feel like it's hard because of the geography of this area. Mm-hmm. You don't hear what's going on. I don't know if there is one resource that I don't know about it to hear more stuff, but I always feel like I'm trying to find out and I can't find it.
There's not even to find out.
Just one resource? There's not many resources at all. I mean, the
communication
in this area is
going on. Yeah.
Right.
Well, this is the deep thing. Again, I mean, even just, and I have a list of 36 theater companies in the triangle, and that's including those that are embedded in schools and those that have no online presence except for, you know, maybe companies that only produce when they have a show and money and to do it. And even within this, it's very difficult to know, because if you also are only, if you have enough this kind of money and you're focusing on the show, building a web presence, right? So having that as an outlet is not necessarily even available to you in the same kind of way. It's getting better. People are using Facebook, things that are free, but they still require maintenance, absolute sort of update, as well as even big companies don't necessarily, like, even just trying to research how many women were directing or how many plays, you can't find it. You can find maybe the name of, if you dig, I found some by reading reviews to find out who directed, because it's not on the season announcement, as well as, like I said at the very beginning, hard to know who's designing, right? The entire breadth of the women that are working on pieces that they're themselves.
That's what this is so awesome. Right. We'll be able to network going forward a little bit.
Yeah.
So, jumping off of that, I can go two ways, but I'm going to do the second one first. How do we, as female theater artisans, collaborate? I mean, we've obviously touched on some of the ways, but there's a disconnect as far as the feeling of competition, of competing with each other, and versus collaborating with each other. That women, you know, like Hope was saying, you didn't want to be the director who only did the plays about, you know, but there are women out there who get into a niche of whatever it is. And I'm not talking like just their inherent abilities. I mean, I am a props master, that is my skill set, and so that is what I do. But for people who have many skill sets and who could do anything, but they instead tend to focus on one thing and then they fight to keep that, versus supporting and collaborating so that everybody gets a piece of the pie, so to speak.
Yeah, when I posted that, I knew I was up in the table of candlelight. And I thought, should I do it? And I was like, yeah, I'd like to do what people have to say, because, I mean, I'll get woo-woo about it, but I think it's a little bit cultural. I think we get, it's a little in our DNA. Caveman to bring home the most food or something, so you can survive. Like, you have to kind of recognize that so you can just let it go, because we don't need to be that way. But I think we give our power away when we do that, because I think we have, as women, of course, a huge intellect and fortitude and drive and everything, of course, that the male gender has. But tell me if I'm wrong, but I think we have all that, and when we go to work and we go like this, it feels kind of crappy. Yeah, we can, but I think what we yearn to do is connect. I think we're great at connection and collaborating. Like, if we had all that, our ideas and our creativity, and instead of going in to compete, go in to collaborate, I think that's very powerful.
But
But I remember someone responding to your comment and agreeing and saying that, you know, part of that it comes from the fact that there are so few things for us to audition for. I mean, I'm speaking as an actor in this case, but I mean, I lost a friendship because I went, my friend and I went to this audition together. We were both called back for this thing. And I was rooting for her, and I do think she was rooting for me too. But then when I got it, and she didn't talk to me. And we fought publicly about it. It was really, really heartbreaking. And I think that's part of where this, I mean, that's definitely where the conversation from that started at Paige's house came from, is that there's so few things, I mean, and I'm speaking as an actor in this particular case, there's so few things for us. I mean, and you know, there's always going to be more women performers than men, but that's the thing, is there, you know, I don't know what the, maybe Jules has the numbers, but I mean, I feel as though there are 5 or 6 or 7 of us for every one of them, and yet all the plays that are chosen for this upcoming season, I mean, that was the original discussion, is that if you look at the theaters that have posted their seasons and have announced them, and those are the bigger ones, but let's be honest, I mean, those are the ones we also pick too, is if you look at their seasons, the majority of them are majorly male. And you can say, well, oh, that's just the play, you know, the director might have a different, but most of them are going to be cast the way they're written. And not that there's anything wrong with that, but I mean, when it comes down to it, that's why there's that competition, because it's really not about, I mean, for some women, it may be part of the joy for them is competing and winning. But for most of us, it's primal. It's because we want to work.
And I agree with you that's a canary in the coal mine. I've been an educator. And when collaboration happens in education, it's when resources are abundant. And when resources get rare, like you're on that roller coaster as an educator, right? Like you see that. Like people are collaborating when resources are plentiful. And as it pares down, that thing we start to guard ours.
You sealed off it.
And again, thinking about this conversation and being positive, I looked to models and I thought of both hands. Mm-hmm. I thought of Diane Paulus. I think that sometimes I thought of Alyssa Brennan, that one of the things that you can do is kind of a stone soup. Mm-hmm. That if you want art to be plentiful for you, do it. Like, shut up and write your show.
Yeah.
Do your show. You know, I think about my friend Mac Rogers, who did a beautiful thing with his play Universe of Robots and flipped genders. Like, historically, when we did the research, Carol and Joseph were the brothers. Well, he didn't have that many men in his company. He had women, so he changed Joseph to Josephine and made them brothers and sisters. And made Rosum the dead widow who thought she was her husband, because that's how he could justify he had a woman to play that role and not a guy. So when you're creating for the people that you already have relationships with, who are women that you want to work with, you're going to make spaces for them. And so that's what we need to do, is start to communicate, like, oh, you want to do a project like this? Let's go do it.
Yeah, that's what I mean.
Quit bitching, start a revolution.
I had to ask myself, well, why haven't I brought a play to a director or a producer and said, this is the one I want to do? And if I haven't, who's going to do it?
Right.
And we collude in it.
Miss Andy, you said about scarcity and you and the pies. I agree with all of this. You just, at some point, you just got to bake a whole new pie.
They get scared if you move your eyes away from one actress to another actress, and then you meet her.
get panicked.
You know, it's a big book of Shakespeare, girl. Just get yourself a sonnet and rock that sonnet, you know? But they know that. And what are they thinking? Because originally those parts weren't written for them anyway.
But, you know, it's weird, though. I find, though, that as a director, it makes the women I have and pick from really, really good. Because they've all been competing against each other. Mm-hmm. That if I'm casting something, I'm spoiled for choice if I do a show with a bunch of women in it.
Because we have to be or we die.
Right, right. You've got to be a contender. But I, you know, was approached by a director recently to direct a show. Not that recently. Time flies when you're... crazy, but it was an all-male show. He said, you know, I really think you need to do this. He was selling it for his company. You need to do this. You need to stop doing all this woman stuff. You know, he didn't say stuff. And I said, well, what are you meaning? And he quoted a couple of shows that I did that, yes, they had 100% female cast of six. And I said, well, you know, it's just economics, man. I mean, the fact is, the labor market was richer for the women. I don't think I can cast this play. Mm. And so I passed on it. I mean, the timing was bad for me, but then someone else handed it to someone else, I presume a man, and he passed on it too, because it wasn't castable. Because it wouldn't work. So it's all about casting what you can cast, because directing is 90% casting anyway, the other 10% is really, really hard. But, you know, I haven't only just done all female shows, I've done shows with men too, and I will continue.
But again, that's a mindset.
Bear,
as opposed to the resources are being established by a larger structure and that we're trying to get into that.
So I think that's your question in short, yes. I think it is definitely an after experience that I've experienced and that lots of women that are a member of the Facebook group have experienced too.
But I think that going back to the whole as you get power, it changes. That starting at the lower end, there is that competition, but then the higher you go.
But I would not assume both that male ADs, or artistic directors, do not cast thoughtfully about gender and do not select seasons about gender. I mean, it's difficult to see sometimes, but I'm keeping the thought in my head that I don't think it's an immediate gender thing, nor do I think a female AD is automatically going to choose a season that has lots of women, hire lots of women, do a lot of that. I mean, I think that too, we get our expectations about either the roadblocks we're going to hit or the collaboration we're going to find cannot be based solely on gender. They have to be based on larger structures than that because those things, I think, have an impact on how people conduct themselves, how they see themselves sort of arguing or wanting to make a name or saying, we do this kind of theater and therefore my choices are based on these kinds of things, not anything else.
I agree with Cheryl. I have not felt that personally. I think that on a personal level, this artist community is incredibly inclusive, incredibly collaborative. I will say, as an educator who thinks about the theater that I see, the seasons that it's chosen, the kinds of ways that we as women are in the conversation philosophically, because I also then have to have those discussions with my students. Like, I went to see blah, 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 and I was really surprised there were, not a lot of ethnicity on the stage. So there wasn't, when my young girls come back from trying on costumes that we borrow from the large equity educational theater and all the ingenue dresses are size 2 or lower, right? That says something to them.
Yes.
So for me, those things are far more a freak when I go see Doubt, and it's not about the women, right? Like, I talk to my girls about how this is a great play for women, and we go, and it's about the priest. I'm pissed. And so those are more frequent irritations for me, and I think that it's this subtle thing that we all know to be politically correct. So we all know to sit at the table and gender, blah, 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 blah. It's the things that get missed, that the in-group sees, that you go, oh, I'm still not heard, I'm still not seen, and someone like me was not at the table to bring it up at the outset.
Gotcha.
You know, like, those are the things that are constantly, like, I'm being blindsided, and that's when I get my, like, why is there not? You know, that's when I get my competitiveness up. I'm like, God, when God, you know?
That I definitely felt that. But not as a competition with other women.
No, but I'm like, why is that not ours? You know, that kind of.
That's a good kind of competition.
But it doesn't, it also, in the same way, I think it doesn't serve. It doesn't serve to just have be mad about it. You know, it doesn't serve to send a nasty email to the Guthrie. How that changes is that there was somebody at the table going, how do we feel about that?
Yeah.
Like, does anyone know that this is kind of offensive to me? That person wasn't at the table. That's what we're angry about. And that doesn't change with us just sending nasty emails.
I do think that, I mean, the benefit of the blow-up about the Guthrie season has been a little bit of institutional, hopefully not navel-gazing, but reflexivity about sort of like, really? I mean, a lot of women sort of going, it's 2012. We're still having a question about you can't find any women writers? I mean, do you know what I mean? Is this sort of saying, I don't doubt that it exists. My first job out of my MFA, I was a guest artist at the university, and I was doing a Brecht piece and had lots of women, and so I was cross-gender casting, and a lot of them were saying, wow, I really like this stuff, I just don't know. And I was doing a play by a man, and she's like, I just don't know plays by women. And I was like, okay, fine. You don't know, you're gonna know. And I made a bibliography. It was like,
American theater sort of there. And it was the year, I think it was the year Oleana was the most done play ever, you know, across the nation. And so I was really desperate to try and say, no, really, I'm not making it up. There are women that write theater, and you can do this theater and all this stuff. Right, exactly. And enjoy it. And some of those plays are awful, and we don't do them anymore because they're not really great plays. But some of these plays are really, really wonderful and could be equally done as much as we do all these other plays if we just knew about them. Because that was 1997, right? I was with a bunch of students that in some sense I kind of felt as we're having this discussion again, and I contribute again to another friend who's trying to put together a list of large cast plays of for women actors as well as by women, and just sort of looking back at my bibliography going, I can't believe I'm still having this conversation. And I feel sort of like, not that I let those women down, the young women that I was teaching, but that I sort of like go, what's the training of the next generation gonna be? Yeah. There's lots of men that are participating in these drama camps. One of the better, or the sort of parody of season is happening, Department of Dramatic Art at UNC, they have 9 shows happening sort of in their undergraduate theater. 6 of them are directed by women. Hmm. Compared to the 25, 26 out of 88 across the triangle. So that's a really, you know, now whether they're all going to be Tony Award-winning directors, or whether they're all going to want to have careers in the theater, but they are working now. And so feeling a little bit of an obligation to sort of say, how do I get at the table? I want to, you know, for a long time it was, I'll just have my own company, and that's how I will make this happen. I will make my own table, and we will sit at it. Children come, people get sick, you cannot maintain that anymore if I'm still wanting to affect the profession, and I'm still seeing this large disconnect institutionally, not amongst people, but a bunch of institutions that do theater. That seems something I still sort of, if that's I'm tilted but that windmill, that I'm still going to do it.
You maybe reminded me of a good point, is that the idea that there aren't very good plays, there aren't really that many very good plays by women, and therefore that when there is a play by a woman that we're doing, that it's events. It can't just be that it's just a play by a woman playwright. It's like we're directing this play by this wonderful woman playwright. It's got to be an event. It's not just. It goes back to, you know, there's going to be an all-female production of Richard II. That's gonna happen in August or September. But it's an event. I mean, it's going to be an event because it's an all-female. It can't just be, oh, we just happened to
have some interesting women there.
Right.
Yes.
Right.
Right.
Well, and it's also the same women. So we're doing women. We're doing Lynn Nottage. Lovely. These are fantastic playwrights. But again, it's sort of like we find the woman. We're doing Lynn Nottage, Sarah Rule, Lorraine Haynesbury, Diana Sun.
And then,
these are all fantastic playwrights. I want to see them done to the end of time. But I also want to see lots of other names.
So we need structures where we get to see or support female playwrights who are up and coming in this area.
Right.
You know.
So we've got about 5 minutes left.
Yes,
I know. Solve it. Okay. You've got the flip chart.
Yes, yeah. World peace.
Right quick, you know, like I said at the beginning, this is just the start of a conversation. This was not to solve anything or to come up with the Grand Master Plan or anything like Mr. But I really want to briefly touch on the subject that Jules, you kind of touched on as well, because there is this giant disparity between companies that we have here. This is almost a yes or no question, but please elaborate. Do we hold them all to the same standard?
For what?
For women. As women working in the theater, do we expect a small company that does a play a season to have 50% female inclusion as we would
a show the season that does 9 shows?
Right. Or is there a gradation?
I don't want to take your question and have answers to that, but I wonder if that is the question, if it's do we actually need to be comparing those theaters, or can we just say generally, can we see improvements? You know what I mean? Like, I don't know if the answer is sort of pit the companies against each other in some sort of competition, right. But rather to see, to take every individual company and say, can we just see improvement in yours? That seems, at least to me, to be hopefully more attainable, and secondly, to be more, to move less in the direction of that competitive mess that we're kind of talking about, and also to just raise awareness about, for each individual company to look at itself, and instead of saying, like, well, we're better than this company, we've got, rather to just say, let's reflect on what we're doing, and can we make some changes?
Are there areas
can we improve on this?
I would also maybe have some questions about whether 50% inclusion is good. First of all, what does inclusion mean? Second of all, is 50%, is that what we're looking
for? I was just throwing it out.
I know you weren't suggesting that as this is what we're trying to do, but I sort of wanted to touch on that just a little bit, because, I don't know, Tamara and I are...
We are 100%. Being part of the conversation as well, and to HowlRound and Life and New Play TV.